pounds. I ballooned to three.
Hey guys, I'm Casey Armstrong. This is WMAP, the world's most amazing people.
Host Casey Armstrong has a really good heart, and I think he actually really cares what the people have to say. And I think that the idea has been great, and all these people have the opportunity to really share their stories and get their word out. I love WMAP because I hear stories that inspire me.
I happen to be of belief that everyone, doesn't matter what it is, it's how you look at it. This is WMAP, the world's most amazing people.
Guys, it's Kellie, and I am lucky enough to be joined by a guest you guys have heard on here before. I have Marilyn Redmond, who is a counselor, author, artist, spiritual teacher, and speaker. Hey, Marilyn, how are you doing?
I'm doing just fine, thank you.
I'm so glad to have you on the show. I love talking with you. I want to give our listeners, before we start, your website, which is angelicasgifts.com, in case they want to look at that while we're talking. But let's start. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about yourself?
Well, yes, I'd love to. I was raised in Seattle, Washington, always lived in Western Washington. So when I went to college, it was just a little further north of Western Washington. Now it's called a university. In those days, it was Western Washington College. And I got my graduate work done at the University of Washington. And I've since then, as I've moved into being a counselor and getting training for that, in additional to having taught school in the last 30 years, I found that I needed to go out of state finally and get some training, and so I flew to Virginia, and a man there was teaching past life therapy, and I wanted to become a counselor, and I knew from the experiences I'd gone through in my growing up and my illnesses, including addictions, mental illness, and domestic violence, and more, that the answers always come in the silence, in the meditative state or altered consciousness. So I was very eager to find out what he could offer and give me and show me through his teachings of how I could help people restore their souls, you might say, their inner consciousness that we don't see. It's kind of, we're like icebergs. What you don't see is what's running our lives. And I was very fortunate to be able to meet up with Henry Bolduc, who's now passed over, but I went to his classes and took his beginning and advanced classes in regression training for past life therapy, which I also use with my clients today. And I've become an internationally board-certified regression therapist, and I'm also on the American Board of Hypnotherapy because what I know is in our is hidden away from our lives. It's below the surface of what we're really truly in touch with, like the iceberg. And when you can bring it up to the surface and shine the light of love on it, you can dispel the problems, and you don't need to take medications. You don't need to find outside help because the answers are always within us. They've just been hidden from our view and our consciousness. And so we bring it into our consciousness, and we can actually, I help people heal themselves is what I do.
Now, you mentioned past life therapy. Can you tell our listeners what that is?
Well, that's a good question because a lot of people misunderstand what that's about. We all have, well, most people generally call it past lives. We all have consciousness that includes all the aspects of our lives we've gone through. And as we come in and out of this life, we have memories that have been hidden from us because if we had it all on our plate at once, it would overwhelm us. So the ones that are conscious for us are the ones that are current, we are now solving. But those that we aren't in touch with are also running our lives. That's what's below the iceberg and the water that you don't see. So when you can get in touch with those memories, those feelings, well, where is that coming from? Well, in my case, I discovered going through his classes, we practiced on each other. I know a lot about my past lives today and how they've influenced my life today. So we're all coming to a place in what I've discovered is time to bring that to the surface, and we don't have to keep it hidden because with the right loving solutions, not going to be running our life anymore, and we're free from it. So it's not really any scary thing. It's actually a welcoming, a making our lives better, enriching our lives to see the whole picture of who we are. Instead of just this one little part and glimpse that we are aware of, we have really a bigger, if we're going to become a whole person. See, a whole person is a mature person. And I like to see people come into their adulthood and maturity. And as you see more of who you are, you can let that be part of your reality today and not keep it hidden, but the reality of the loving part of you can come, and those different pieces that have splintered off from harm and difficulties in growing up or whatever has come into your life to cause you to go into fear or trauma or to shut down your system because you are afraid to face reality. All those things can be glued back together with love, and you can become a whole spirit, a holy spirit. And so most of us are damaged and splintered, and that's what I like to do is bring those pieces back together and make us whole again.
Now, I really love your message, Marilyn, and you give these talks to people. You know, you're a speaker. Now, I'm sure that can't always go 100% smoothly. I'm sure you hit certain things that can be maybe challenging when you're giving these talks. For instance, one of the talks you were going to give, I believe you stated that your husband showed up with his girlfriend, which was really tough for you.
It was, because, you know, if you're married, and you've, in that case I was married for 30 years, and I was trying to be the perfect wife and the perfect mother and the perfect teacher in my case, as I mentioned, and all of a sudden, you know, here's this big betrayal. And, well, why was that? Because, you know, we were in the process of getting a divorce, and, of course, I'm going to be edged out of that situation. And it had been my lifeline to be married. I didn't know in those days I was emotionally 3 years old. And to go out on the in the world without a husband or a father or a family, I didn't really have a family supporting me in my spiritual growth and outgrowing the family problems. I was going to be totally abandoned and a scary, difficult place to be. So, you know, we've all gone through abandonment issues at one time in our life or another, and to find that we've always been loved by a loving, benevolent spirit of the universe, and I can place myself in the arms of that loving energy. Most people call it God, or some people call it a higher power. You can call it whatever you want. It's an invisible energy in all of us. When we find that love in our hearts, then we can turn to that love for our support and our nurturing and taking care of us. Believe it or not, our needs actually pop up in our lives to take care of us when that happens, when we've turned our life over to that love. And I was able to walk away from that situation, and I actually started to drive home thinking, this is a bad spot to be. I'm, you know, abandoned. And that I didn't know the word abandoned in those days, but that's how it felt. And all of a sudden, I started laughing because I'd found a spiritual loving path at that point. Mm-hmm. And it dawned on me, she was going to get the abuse. I was off the hook, and I had a loving creator that was going to take care of me, and he never took care of me. My parents didn't know how. I was really a child that raised myself. I never had anybody in my life take care of me, and all of a sudden, I burst out laughing. I was in a better place because he had found somebody else. I was not that upset person. Very quickly, my attitude and emotions changed, and it was like, I'm off the hook. This is going to be better than it was.
Wow. And that is such a refreshing way to look at it, too, because there's so many people in relationships where abuse takes place, and I find that a lot of times when, you know, the people break up and someone takes on, you know, a new partner, it's very hard to let go, even with that abuse and even with the, you know, tumultuous things that go on in that relationship. But the way you view it as, well, it's someone else's problem now, it's so great, and it really is therapeutic.
Well, for me it was. It gave me a basis upon which to grow and improve myself so I could outgrow being that victim. I could outgrow being that for me and into my survival, and I was very much into survival. It was not a comfortable place. It was totally a new comfort zone to grow into. But, you know, when you have that loving basis in your life, and in my newest book, finding reality beyond fear, it takes you from where I was at the very beginning of what we're just talking about and how I came through the stages and steps leading into moving into the life today where I really actually feel like an adult and have mature responses to life. It's really an amazing trip, and it's possible.
Yeah. Now, some of the things that you've had in your experience was a dysfunctional family of alcoholism, mental illness, and sexual abuse, and you've really been able to, you know, take those experiences and keep moving forward. And, you know, a lot of people do get stuck in those experiences, and they have a really hard time moving forward. And the way you've been able to do it was by becoming a writer, becoming a counselor, and becoming a speaker. And, you know, especially you said using meditation and guidance for direction.
Exactly. It's been a process. You don't just grow up overnight. My spiritual teacher says growing up is not for sissies. There are some times when the old situations leave, and it can be painful to, in my case, there was a lot of physical abuse. Mm-hmm. And so my body tightened up to protect myself. That's the ego wanting to protect you. And when you release those needs for protection and you want to relax, you know, our society puts so much fear in people, and we stress ourselves out so badly, our body gets really tense and tight. And so we're trying to protect ourselves, but the more you can relax and realize, oh, I'm putting the stress on myself, I don't need to do that. You know, if somebody is putting you in a stressful situation, leave, get out of it. You don't need to stay there and endure that, which I did for a 30-year marriage. Mm-hmm. So, you know, actually it was putting me into a place where I could finally relax in my body. And as you're the vital life force or prana, however you want to call that energy that moves through us, the Chinese called it qi. The more we can allow that to happen, the healthier and more functional we become. And we move out of the past harms and don't keep replaying them in our head. And we move into the now, which is reality. Right now, I have love in my heart. My life is going. The transmission in my car went out, and I'm in the process of getting a new, better car because the old one is leaving. Yeah. So when you can see the benefits of what's coming, to let go of what you don't want and you can focus on what you do want, your life can change into being really a prosperous, abundant life that is full of joy.
No, that's so true. Now, I wanted to ask, because I know in your book, Roses Have Thorns, Encouragement on Evolving from Pain to Joy, you talk about angels and how they've helped to keep you alive. Now, I know there's many people that believe in angels and some that don't, but I would love to hear more about your experience with that, because I think our listeners, it would help, you know, it really helps to give encouragement and something else to believe in. What was some of your experiences with angels, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, I love to. In fact, I think that was going to be my next book, is sharing my angel experiences. I've had so many. I've almost died 12 times, and guess what? They've been there for me. To pull me through in the various situations I find myself in, and some were actual medical situations and not just trying to do myself in. Mm-hmm. So they've shown up in various ways. Gosh, where to start? The first time I was consciously, I somehow knew there was spiritual support. You know, we all have angels in our lives, if we recognize it or not. But the first time I actually recognized angels were in my life was when I tried suicide. Mm-hmm. And I'd tried it several times, but that time I really was going to go out. As far as I was concerned, there was no hope, and I had no answers. And, I, of course, as I said, I was 3 years old emotionally and had never grown up, so I didn't know where to turn. And I started taking the Valium from the doctor, and I had a nice little stash in case I ever needed them. In those days, they were very cheap. Prescriptions were pretty cheap at one time. I could get 100 for a dollar through the insurance company. And so I had my little stash, and I was in a very, very distraught situation with my husband. Mm-hmm. He was threatening to kill me. And so I figured, well, if that's the case, I might as well just leave.
Yeah.
And as I was taking the pills, and angels appeared. I know today I have 6 angels in my life. They're wonderful. They're with me every day, and I'm consciously in connection with them every day. And they put a gold rope around my arms and said to stop taking the pills. and told me what to do. I was to go home. It was safe enough to, I was only a mile from my home, mm-hmm. and it was safe enough to drive. It wasn't a main road. It was a very much of a back road, and to go home and just sleep it off. And so that's what I did. And then the next time I recognized them is my husband and I had taken the kids to California for Disneyland, and we went on into Mexico. And on the way coming home, we wanted to stop at the Grand Canyon because in my teaching, I was teaching Indians, and I wanted some artifacts. And so we were to stop at the Grand Canyon on the way home. Well, it was an icy, snowy winter vacation, and the snow came a day earlier than planned by the radio. So we talked it over and thought, is it safe to go up there? It's 8,000 feet. And decided, well, it's a national park. The road shouldn't be any problem. Well, we actually hit the road before the sander. The sander was right behind us and watched the whole thing. A car was coming towards us in the middle of the highway, and there was not much of a shoulder on the right side. And it was, should we go around him on the left or the right? Well, the right was the canyon side. And we decided we really didn't know it was on the other side, so we thought hopefully there'd be a big enough shoulder. Well, there wasn't.
Wow.
And so we hit ice as he was coming toward us, and we were trying to dodge him and went off the cliff. Now, I'm probably the only person, according to the rangers, that ever went off the cliff at the Grand Canyon and walked out without a scratch. The angels took the car. I could feel their hands take the car. And as we were sliding, the car went upside down, and so they took the car in their hands and put us, there was a piece of land that jutted out from the side of the cliff, thank God, about 40 feet down, and laid us upside down very gently. And there we were with the smashed in top of our station wagon and all of us inside intact. Since the sander had seen the whole accident, he called for help immediately. And we all walked out without a problem and got the car fixed enough so we could drive it home, in fact.
Wow.
So those were the first two times. In fact, I've been off another cliff where angels literally picked up the front end of the car between Banff and Jasper and the national parks in Canada and put the front end of the car back on the road because he had passed out at the wheel and was not able to drive because he wasn't functioning. And the car headed for the cliff and was halfway off the cliff when the angels showed up, put the front end. I saw them actually pick up the car and put the front end on the roadway and had actually took my hand on the wheel and made the wheels turn inward towards the road so we wouldn't have the wheels going the wrong direction and put us safely back on the road. So since I see angels, I do paint people's angels. I talk to my angels all the time, and I actually see angels. And I've actually had angels come into human form. Actually, 2 weeks ago, I was teaching a class, and this man showed up, and he glowed. You know, he just glowed. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Nobody walks into this class. It's a beginning spiritual class for teaching, you know, what it's about. Nobody walks into a beginner's class with this kind of a bright light around them. And I thought, well, that's kind of interesting. And then as we got through the class further, I happened to sit down right across from him at one point, and I could feel his heart was just really lovely. I says, you have a good heart. And he said, thank you, with this big beam on his face.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end of the class, I helped him with what he had was supposedly a concern of what I do in there for the class to help people solve their problems. So as we were heading out, his problem got solved, and he was saying, what can I do to help you? And I have arthritis, and to carry the big bag of books I use for the class in and out of the car is kind of a difficult thing for me. So I said, if you wouldn't mind, could you carry the books out to my car? And he did, and I went to turn around and thank him, and he was gone. Mm-hmm. Nobody in the parking lot. And then it dawned on me, he was an angel. I'd had car trouble once going to my grandson's in Idaho from, I live in Washington, and an angel stopped and helped me get my car tire changed so I could continue my trip for Thanksgiving that year to go see my grandchildren. And that time I went to turn around and thank the person, and he was gone. And so I've had several angels actually appear in human form. So they're
incredible.
All around us, and they will talk. We can have conversations with them in our head.
Mm-hmm.
It's not being crazy. If it's positive and loving, it's from God. and to trust it. So I've had some wonderful guidance and direction in my meditations from my angels, from God, from I also am in touch with masters, and I have several masters that are helping me in my life and help me write my books. So, you know, it's a very real thing, because what's invisible is powerful, mm-hmm. and what we see and touch is just the manifestation of what's invisible, and that's what Einstein's theory was all about.
Now, speaking of books, you just wrote a new book called Finding Reality Beyond Fear, and this is your fourth book?
No, it's actually my 10th book.
Oh, I apologize. Yes, I knew you had written more. I know we have a couple of the names here, but you've written a lot of books. So this is your newest book, Finding Reality Beyond Fear. Can you tell our listeners about the book?
Yeah, I'll clarify the number. The other ones that aren't in paperback are e-books, and they're not paperback books, but I include them as books I've written.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so, Finding Reality, this is what I've discovered. If we stay in fear, guilt, shame, resentment, anger, those are all low energies, and they're not real. They're not loving from a loving creator. Mm-hmm. Reality is all love. It's all about love, and that's what paradise was about when Adam and Eve were created. They were one with God. They were one in love, unconditional love. And so that's reality, and we've left that wonderful space and bought into the human, you know, it's really sad on the internet how they always find what's wrong with people. That's just what's wrong with medicine. They find out what's wrong with you, or people are critical and judgmental. All of that is not reality. The real you is a perfect being, so, and healthy, and you don't need you don't need other things to heal you, because the love's within you. Mm-hmm. So what I did in this book was take my progression of how I came through my denial that, you know, there were angels or other higher powers that were here to help me, and how I went through the steps of growing into outgrowing the fear of the past, abuse and harms that you've mentioned earlier. And that's what we really do, is we add a little more love each time that we are in counseling or in meditation or experiencing spiritual groups. We're learning to put a little more love into our life, and as we add the light of love, which is the same light and love, it's a positive energy, and it pushes out the darkness, which is the fear, guilt, shame, and all the lower energy, which people often are stuck in, as you mentioned. So when you start to say, I want to move out of this illusion of fear into the light of the truth of reality, we move into growing up, is what it amounts to. And the second part of the book is finding balance. So we've moved into grace through the first part of the book, and as you find balance, there's ways in your life that will help you keep that balance, because when we change comfort zones, it's uncomfortable to move. Most people don't want to change.
Mm-hmm.
So there's little slogans in there to help remind you to take it easy, this too shall pass. I had to think things out for myself instead of think like the box I was taught to think in, like for church. I don't think in that box anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, when we says, let it there be peace and let it begin with me, we change ourselves and then our reality changes. So part three then shows you how you can do that for all kinds of medical issues that I've gone through, healing my alcoholism, addictions, domestic violence, mental illness. And the solution is to, and one of the suggestions in this book, I have a lot more suggestions in my Paradigm Busters Reveal the Real You book, but in this book the suggestion is how to use water, which will change the energy in your system, because you're using mostly water in your body, 80%, mm-hmm. and if you put loving words around your drinking water, that loving drinking water will literally change your consciousness inside. So there are answers to bring you into higher consciousness, mm-hmm. into the love of the universe. And the last part of the book is letting go of that fear so that you can move into being the true you. It explains alchemy. Excuse me. Mm-hmm. Alchemy in my throat. And so as we move out of the dark, dense, metal energy of our lives, the fear based, everything's based in fear that usually is running us, and as we move into that higher consciousness of love, we become the gold that the alchemists were looking for. So it's all within us, and it was hidden in this story of alchemy because back in the older ages, the church did not allow other thinking other than the church dogma, and so they hid it in the understanding of alchemy. But you are the alchemist of your system, of your life, and you can be the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow.
Wow. And that, again, I mean, your messages are just so powerful. And the fact that it goes to really, for people to better themselves. And that's what you're talking about. And you're giving people ways to do it. It's such a beautiful thing that you're doing. And in case anyone's just joining us, I've been speaking with Marilyn Redmond. And her website is angelicasgifts.com. So you can go there to find more information about her books, including her newest book, Finding Reality Beyond Fear, which, I mean, I'm excited about. It sounds wonderful. Now, when did the book get released?
Well, it actually came out 2 weeks ago, and I'm getting great, wonderful, wonderful reviews. And on Amazon, all my books are available on Amazon, Marilyn L. Redmond. I have an author page. And my last review that was just put up for this book was absolutely astounding. It was, she struck it out of the ballpark. It was like a home run. If you have any concerns about this book, go check out the review for Finding Reality Beyond Fear by Linda Schiller-Hanna. She really understood the message that I was trying to portray in that book very, very well. She put it into words better than I could have. So check it out, and I know that you'll just be really happy if you're looking for a better way to enrich your life, as you mentioned, Kellie, to make, basically what we're doing is we're learning to grow up, and we don't have to live in our little childish ways, you know. Anger is just a little kid throwing a temper tantrum. I gave up anger. I don't have to be a little kid anymore.
And that's so freeing. No, I also want to mention to our listeners that you have a call-in show every Tuesday, and it's called Love Always Heals. Now, can you tell us a little bit about the call-in show?
Well, I actually gave you, you surprised me when you called. This show is actually called Love Never Fails.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay, because I screwed up myself. And I get nervous sometimes.
That's okay.
Yeah, it's every Tuesday afternoon at 3 o'clock Pacific time. And if you go to boldbravemedia.com or have access to Sirius Radio or TuneIn Radio, you go to their site and click on my picture. We'll be there with Love Never Fails. There's a bunch of trees behind me on the picture of who I am. And click on that. You can. We just did a radio show yesterday about holistic health, and we're going to continue with that topic next Tuesday. Our first show was about domestic violence, and I followed up on yesterday's show with kind of an epilogue. But people are supposed to call in with their questions. It's a call-in talk show. And just for everyone's information, the number is 866-451-1451. And you can call in with your questions, and I wish people would. We had a question yesterday. I answer questions on Quora on the Internet, and actually 4,300 people read my answers last week. So I know there's a lot of people curious with questions, so don't just write them in, but also call. We'd love to hear from you as far as calling in. I also have, besides my website and my books at Amazon.com, I have a blog at marilynredmondbooks.blogspot.com, and I have over 133 videos on YouTube.
Wow, Marilyn, you are a busy woman. How do you find time to do everything that you do?
Well, one of the things that I wrote in this paradigm, in my last book, Finding Reality, is we do the next indicated thing. I have a list, basically, of what I need to do for, you know, my career, I guess you'd call it, counseling and giving readings and writing, and that part of it I call my business. So I have a list, and I what's the next thing that needs to be done, and I finish that, go to the next thing, go to the next thing. And I do the same thing with the different parts of my life. If it's my social life, I have a social life too. You know, there's certain things on the calendar. Well, this is what we need to do, you know, that particular time. And so it's just taking life one day at a time, one moment at a time. I have found the rest falls into place. It's not like I have to, my old way was to make a list of maybe 24 things for the day, and if I didn't get it finished, I couldn't go to bed that night. It was just too frustrating.
Mm-hmm.
But today, if I even get the first thing done, it's a success because the rest of the things seem to fall in place, and it's not overwhelming. Have you heard the story about how do you eat an elephant one bite at a time?
Well, Marilyn, I absolutely love your message, and you're such a great guest. I want to thank you so much for being on our show today. Thank you for sharing everything with us and, you know, giving us all this really great information.
Well, thank you for having me, and please send me the link to this show. I'd love to have a copy.
Of course. We definitely will do that. Thank you so much. And again, everyone, go to angelicasgifts.com to find more information about Marilyn Redmond. Thanks again for being on the show today.
And Kellie, thanks for asking me. Have a great day yourself.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, guys, that was Marilyn Redmond. She's a wonderful guest, so we have some other people coming up, so stay tuned.
Neon vistas, castles made of laser light. Take us to